Hello and welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today I'll go over the RAS system and how it pertains to fluid balance in the body. I'll also cover other mechanisms that are important for blood pressure regulation as well as RAS antagonists. So let's get started. So RAS stands for renin, angiotensin, and aldosterone system. Basically, what that means, if the blood pressure for some reason drops, this is all in response to low blood pressure, the liver will excrete a hormone called angiotensinogen. Angiotensinogen then also works on the kidney, and the kidney will release renin. Both of them will combine to angiotensin 1. And think about angiotensin, a lot of the words that we use in physiology are very kind of intuitive. So angio meaning blood vessel, tensin meaning tense. So it causes vasoconstriction. If the blood vessel gets really tight, it will cause an increase in blood pressure. So now if the blood pressure is normalized, every organ, liver, and kidney have normal perfusion again, everything goes back to normal. However, if the blood pressure remains low, and just by secreting the angiotensin 1, the low blood pressure problem hasn't been resolved, angiotensinogen then will cause the lungs to release ACE, angiotensin converting enzyme. These two will combine and form angiotensin 2. So just think about angiotensin 1 being potent, angiotensin 2 being more potent. Again, angiotensin make the blood vessels tense, vasoconstriction, therefore causing an increase in blood pressure. If the blood pressure now is back to normal, every organ that's involved here gets nicely perfused, homeostasis is back in balance, everything is good, and the RAS will kind of go back to sleep until it's needed again. If the blood pressure here again remains low, then the angiotensin 2 works on the adrenal gland on top of the kidney, and then the kidney will release aldosterone. And aldosterone works again on the kidney, but this time it helps to increase the absorption of sodium and water, and we know if we have more fluid in our system, the blood pressure will be increased. Then, again, that mechanism kicks in and that feedback loop is restored. So now if there's a normal blood pressure, the RAS, again, all these hormones go back to normal and everything is, homeostasis is reestablished. So a very, very potent sequence of events here that takes place just to make sure our blood pressure is normal. Now, besides the RAS, we also have other mechanisms that help us regulate blood pressure. So inside our two cerebral hemispheres, we have the pituitary gland that releases antidiuretic hormone, which the name kind of gives it away, it antidiuresis. So what it does, ADH works on the kidney and it decreases sodium and water excretion, therefore holding on to more fluid in the intravascular space, and blood pressure is increased. So that's another mechanism that helps us regulate our blood pressure. Now then we have the RAS antagonists. And whenever you think about antagonists, think about something that counteracts the effect of something else. So in this case, the RAS antagonists, AMB and BNP, counteract the RAS system. So now if the problem is not low blood pressure, but high blood pressure. Now we have too much fluid in our intravascular space, and ANP is located in the atria, where BNP is located in the ventricles of the heart. And both of those will be released in response to an increased stretch of the heart muscles in the atria and ventricles because of fluid volume excess. So if the blood pressure is too high and the sodium is high, these hormones will be released from their locations in the heart. They are natural antagonists to the RAS system, and therefore suppress renin, angiotensin 1, angiotensin 2, and aldosterone. So this whole mechanism of increasing blood pressure here is basically negated because we already have too much volume and too high of a blood pressure in our system. And it does that, and then it increases the excretion of water and sodium, and therefore less water, less sodium in the system, decreases the blood volume, therefore it decreases blood pressure. So a very important counteracting mechanism here. And in a normal, healthy individual, these systems really work together to balance each other out. Important to note that the kidneys are basically the major regulators here of our fluid balance, as well as our pituitary gland that plays a role with the antidiuretic hormone. Now, here's some extra caveats. So there are certain medications that we can use for patients who have high blood pressure. So this whole system will basically not work. And my ACE disappeared here. So this is the typical mechanism, the usual mechanism of our RAS. Now, there are medications called ACE inhibitors, which are very frequently used medications. And what ACE inhibitors do, they just inhibit this angiotensin converting enzyme from being produced. And so then, since we can't produce the angiotensin converting enzyme, the RAS system, basically as far as it can go, is the angiotensin 1. Therefore, this whole following mechanism is blocked, and all these attempts to increase blood pressure are negated. And this is for patients who have hypertension, which is a very common problem in today's population. Now, very important to note that ACE inhibitors usually end in prill. So I highly encourage you to note the endings of classes of medications, because they will all have the same mechanism of action, the same side effects, the same nursing interventions. So ACE inhibitors are prill medications, and that will be something like lisinopril, captopril, and so forth. So if you see a patient is on lisinopril, for example, you already know it's an ACE inhibitor. It works on the RAS and all the different organ that it can affect, and then you have to kind of assess your patient accordingly. Now, another class of medications that work here on the RAS are called ARBs, angiotensin receptor blockers. And they end in TAN. So ARBs basically prevents the angiotensin 2 from working on the kidney, from binding here with the adrenal gland and causing that release of the aldosterone. So they basically, the mechanism here can go as far as the angiotensin 2, and then the ARBs halt the whole following mechanism. Angiotensin receptor blockers, so therefore aldosterone is not produced and the sodium and water reabsorption that we have there is negated. Now, other medications, which kind of pretty self-explanatory, are diuretics here. And diuretics will basically work on counteract the antidiuretic hormone. So now we give the patients diuretics. And there are three different types of diuretics, which are the thiazide diuretics, the loop diuretics, and the potassium sparing diuretics. And they basically just work on different parts of the kidney to help decrease the sodium and water reabsorption and increase the excretion of sodium and water, therefore to decrease the blood pressure. So thiazide diuretics, very easy, and in thiazide. And probably the most prominent one would be hydrochlorothiazide. You'll see that very often abbreviated as HZTZ. Now loop diuretics work on the loop of Henle in the kidney, and they are typically potassium wasting diuretics. And that is something like furosemide, so they end in "ide," which is also called Lasix. You've probably heard of Lasix or furosemide before. And then we have the potassium sparing diuretics, which basically also work on the kidney, again, to help excrete more sodium and water, but they hold on to more potassium. Therefore, we have to also watch what's happening with our potassium. And this will be something like aldosterone or spironolactone, and they will end in "-one." Very important to notice here that all the different blood pressure medications that we just discussed, ACE inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers, as well as the different types of diuretics, they all have something to do with the kidney. The kidney plays a big role in fluid and electrolyte balance. Therefore, whenever a patient is on these medications, we have to watch kidney functions, so creatinine and BUN, as well as our electrolytes, because we know that the kidney exchanges these electrolytes for others. And so if the patient is taking a potassium wasting diuretic, we have to keep a close eye because they're at risk for hypokalemia. Many times patients who are on a loop diuretic will be on a potassium replacement that they'll take on a daily basis. So when patients are on any kind of blood pressure medication, specifically ACE inhibitors, ARBs, or diuretics, we will have to monitor kidney function and their electrolytes, specifically if the patient has this medication that's new to them. So because we don't know the effect that it's going to have on their kidney, so it's very important to monitor these lab values to ensure that the patient is taken care of and has no adverse effects on their kidneys or electrolyte balance. So thank you for watching the summary of the RAS system with its antagonist, as well as other mechanisms for blood pressure control. I hope it has helped you understand the mechanisms more. Please feel free to leave comments in the section below. I'll be happy to also help you review any other topics that you might want me to go over in the future. And thank you for watching again. Thank you for watching Nursing School Explained.